Hello viewers, today I shall tell you how I perform subjective refraction in my patients to get the perfect result every time. The patient should be told beforehand what exactly is expected of her and that her responses are very crucial in obtaining the correct refractive correction. These few minutes should not be dispensed with at any cost, as otherwise you may not get the kind of accurate information that you desire. So what exactly would you be telling your patients prior to subjective refraction? Often I will ask you which choice of lens is better, and you may find that with both, the letters on the chart are blurred. Even if they are, just tell me, of the two, which is a little bit better. For example, you can say, both are blurred, but the second lens is better than the previous one.
Okay, doctor.
Don't think too much. As soon as I place the lens, tell me which is better. If you're not sure, just say so.
Okay, doctor.
When deciding which lens is better, do not consider when the line becomes just darker and sharp. Say it is better only if you can read more letters or read the existing letters more clearly without hesitation compared to before.
Okay, doctor.
So, shall we start?
Sure, doctor.
Now, place the trial frame with the frame centered on the pupils and occlude the left eye. Ask the patient to read the chart. Basically, you are rechecking the visual acuity. Often you find it is different to what you have checked earlier. The right eye is tested first by convention. If, however, the vision in the left eye is significantly worse or patient does not appear to be too cooperative, then go for whichever eye has the worst vision. Now, place a sphere in the trial frame. What power sphere do you place? If the patient has been wearing glasses previously, the sphere power of that prescription is placed. If you have performed retinoscopy or have used an auto refractor, then make an adjustment for the distance correction and place a lens with a power that is numerically smaller than what you have obtained. For example, if you have obtained, say, -3 diopters after distance correction, start with around -1.5. And if you have obtained +2 diopters, you can start with +1. If you have obtained, say, -6 diopters, you can start with around -4. These are just rough estimates and are not hard and fast. Gradually increase the numerical value of the sphere till there is no further improvement. So let's say we start with -1.5. How is this? Read some letters.
I can read one line extra, no more.
What about this?
Almost. One or two letters in the last line are not very clear.
What about this?
No, those two letters are not very clear.
How is this?
The last line is very dark, but those two letters are not okay.
So we notice that between -2.5 and -3, there is no difference between the number of letters that can be read. So let's go back to -2.5 and try a cylinder. Ideally, it would be good to use a Jackson cross cylinder for this purpose. I developed this technique for those that don't have a Jackson cross cylinder. Now, since we do not want to increase the sphere beyond 2.5 unless necessary, I try with a +0.5 cylinder. What this essentially does is it reduces the minus power by 0.5 in the axis perpendicular to which the cylinder has been placed. So if I add this at 90 degrees, what I am doing is at 180, the effective power becomes -2, while the power in the vertical meridian remains the same. Now how do you find it?
Yes, this is good.
So either the patient will say this is good or bad. Either way, rotate the cylinder 90 degrees and see the response and select the axis that is the better of the two.
No, this is very bad.
So since this is bad, let us go back. Now try to refine the axis. Always refine the axis of the cylinder prior to its power. When you rotate the cylinder in the frame itself, sometimes patients find it difficult to make out the difference between two choices. So you can tell them, this is option A. Now I am changing to option B. Which is better?
Option A is better.
Okay, this is option B. And this is option C.
Option C is better.
Now this is option A.
This is much better.
What about now?
Not good.
Now?
Getting better.
Now?
Yes, this is good.
Sometimes the patient is unable to appreciate minor changes when you rotate within the frame. In such cases, I find it useful to hold the two combinations separately in my hands and place them alternately. For example, and this way the patient can tell you which is better. So the patient has accepted this combination. So basically this is a compound myopic astigmatism. So we shall use the transposed form. Now what I do is I check various combinations, each time asking the patient what she prefers. So as you can see here, we are covering absolutely every possible combination. What you achieve by this is double and triple checking to make sure you have the right combination. After trying all these, it would still be worth trying to cross-check if any cylinder combination is really better than a pure sphere. Okay, now do you remember the stage when we first added a cylinder? What if neither this nor this were to be accepted by the patient? In such cases, try with a minus 0.5 diopter in one or other meridian and then use the principles described earlier to refine both sphere and cylinder. If neither plus nor minus 0.5 is accepted, you may try a slightly higher cylinder using the same principles. Now, if you don't have a previous spectacle prescription or a retinoscopy value to go with, and you're going for a subjective refraction blindly, since you do not know what baseline sphere to place for the first time, take a call based on the visual acuity. The following table would give an approximate idea. After some time, you won't really need to refer to such a table. The worse the vision, a greater power lens is tried. However, you don't know if the patient is myopic or hypermetropic. So let's say the patient has a visual acuity of 6/24. It would be a good idea to try around 1.5 to 2 diopters. And ask the patient which is better. The patient obviously would respond that one or the other is better. So depending on which is better, you can take it from there based on the previous principles. If you are dealing with a hearing impaired person, not a problem. Simply show both choices to them, place them alternately, and then gesture the question, which is better. Ultimately, choose the least minus or the greatest plus for the sphere and the least numerical value of the cylinder that is acceptable to the patient. As for presbyopic correction, find out the exact profession of the patient, and secondly, let them hold the near vision chart at the same distance as they would for their chosen near work. Test each eye individually and give the least near add that makes them comfortable at that distance. So that's it for today. If you like what you saw, subscribe to my channel and hit the bell icon to never miss an update from AP's Ophthalmology Pulse. You may watch my other videos by clicking on the thumbnails. Please leave a note in the comment section if you wish for any particular topic to be covered in future. Look forward to regular updates. Thank you for watching.